Professor of Special Education, Director, the Kansas University Center on Developmental Disabilities, and Associate Director, Beach Center on Disability, all at the University of Kansas. He is the author of more than 180 articles or book chapters and has authored, co-authored, or co-edited 19 books on disability and education-related issues. He is a fellow of the American Association on Mental Retardation, a past president of the Council for Exceptional Children's Division on Career Development and Transition, and is editor-in-chief for the journal Remedial and Special Education. Dr. Wehmeyer holds undergraduate and master's degrees in special education from the University of Tulsa and a master's degree in experimental psychology from the University of Sussex in Brighton, England, where he was a Rotary International Teacher of the Handicapped Fellow. He earned his PhD in Human Development and Communication Sciences from the University of Texas at Dallas, and this evening he is here to discuss his new book, Good Blood, Bad Blood, Science, Nature, and the Myth of the Kallikaks, and please give him a big hand.
Well, thank you, Heidi. That was unnecessary, but most of it's true, but one of my bosses is here, so we won't identify which parts.
I apologize for
the Well, thank you all for taking part of your Friday evening to come and listen. Hopefully, the story will make your time worthwhile, because I think it is a compelling story. And it's a bit of a, and I want to say thank you to Heidi for the opportunity and a chance to support Lawrence's independent bookstore. So whether you buy Good Blood or Bad Blood or not, buy something. So and to Karen Harris with, Henry, with LSI. I worked with Karen Harris, so that was for arranging this and your support. So about a decade ago, a colleague of mine, David Smith, who was then at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, and I decided it was time to act on a compelling wish to tell a story that Dave, as you'll learn about tonight, has worked in this area of social justice and equity for people with intellectual and developmental disabilities all his life, but more specifically in kind of these issues of the history of intellectual disability and how intellectual disability is understood. And I had become a fan of his over the years, and then had become interested in pursuing some of this stuff. So we started talking about telling this story in about a decade ago. And we approached this differently than I have and many of you in the room have in terms of writing text and books for academic audiences, in that we wanted this to be accessible to a lay reader, the general public, because we think it's a story that is of interest to people in the disability world, but it's a story that is important and I think of interest for all Americans. And so, unknown. And I'm going to tell you all three of those rather than holding those back, knowing that, again, you'll want to support your local indie bookstore and you'll buy it or something. So I'm going to start, and I have pictures that I've put together. And if you don't get too dizzy from things flying in and out, I think it'll help. But I'm kind of scripted on this, so you'll pardon me if I seem to be looking down here as much, because I'm also having to try to figure out how to move the Prezi without knocking things off. So I'm going to start by reading the opening paragraph of our book, and it begins with a quote from the original source, the Kallikak family. One bright October day, 14 years ago, there came to the training school at Vineland a little 8-year-old girl. So began the Kallikak family. Psychologist Henry Herbert Goddard's 1912 best-selling pseudoscientific treatise extolling the tale of the supposedly degenerate family from rural New Jersey. The Kallikaks family, like most books in the eugenic family genre, describe generations of illiterate, poor, and purportedly immoral Kallikaks family members who were chronically unemployed, feeble-minded, criminal, and in general, perceived as threats to the nation's racial hygiene. And that's a term you see used a lot, those of you who are, who know that era. Talk, you know, there's lots of talk about racial hygiene. And I would just note on the side, I brought in a lot of sources from my office, and there are several other examples of these kinds of eugenic family narratives. And there was one, there was a Kansas eugenic family narrative that I can't remember the name of, but you know, we had one too. So, the first chapter of the Kallikaks family introduced the pseudonymous Deborah Kallikaks, right here, who was an inmate at the Institution for the Feeble-Minded, the Vineland Training School, at which Goddard had established a pioneering psychological research laboratory. Goddard was got his doctorate from G. Stanley Hall, who psychologists in the room will know was the first minted PhD in psychology in America and really the early pioneer of psychology. So, and this was the first psychological laboratory established outside of an institution, and it was at a university. So it was, and it was housed at this this institution for people who were called feeble-minded. Goddard's tale of Deborah and her ancestors, published in 1912, reigned as seemingly conclusive proof of the hereditary nature of intelligence, feeble-mindedness, criminal behavior, and degeneracy for literally decades, and was used by American eugenicists justify their racially and politically charged rhetoric and policies, resulting in the institutionalization and forced sterilization of many of our nation's most vulnerable citizens. Goddard derived the name Kallikaks from the Greek words kalos, meaning beauty, and kakos, meaning bad. So Kallikaks, kalos, kakos. And that was, of course, Goddard's dramatic way of capturing the essence of the story of the Kallikaks family, one branch of which was good, the other branch of which was bad, and I'll give you more detail. So the you know, good blood, bad blood. America's most rabid eugenicists were men like biologist Charles B. Davenport, who was director of the Eugenics Record Office, and his assistant, Assistant Director Harry Hamilton Laughlin, who was from Missouri, but married his wife, who was also very active in the movement, was from Kansas, so there's our Midwest connection to the Eugenics Record Office. And Goddard worked with both of these folks frequently to further the eugenic, one of his first publications was with that group. And so he was working with them to further their negative eugenic objectives and strategies to limit breeding among the unfit. In case you're wondering, and you know, need to know, and you know, for whatever reason, this includes segregation through institutionalization. So segregate people, lock them up, and you know, they can't reproduce. Laws restricting marriage, which were passed across the country. So if you had epilepsy, if you had any mental defect, as it would be called, you were restricted from marriage. And then, increasingly, through the years, the forced involuntary sterilization of people deemed unfit or unworthy. Now, we don't have the time tonight to go into any depth in the American eugenics movement, but the Kallikaks family was clearly intended to show that the people deemed as feeble-minded were menaces to society, and that feeble-mindedness was an inherited trait that that we needed to do something about. Here's Goddard writing again. The difficulty began with a nameless, feeble-minded girl. Had she been taken care of, all of this trouble would have been avoided. being taken care of course, meant being segregated from society through institutionalization or through sterilization. So clearly, the Kallikak family is written to further that the eugenics movement's focus on negative gender. But there were three other purposes of the book, all that were more self-serving to Goddard himself. First, Goddard coined the now familiar term moron. So we have the term moron in the English language because of Henry Herbert Goddard. He emulated Galton, and he went to the Greek moros, as in sophomore, and moros means stupid, and coined this term moron. And he used it to refer to a classification system of the highest functioning group of people then referred to as feeble-minded. So he had coined this term as a way to describe people in the upper regions of functioning of people who were feeble-minded. And we reveal is that, in fact, Goddard got the genealogy of the Wolverton family dead wrong. In 2001, David McDonald and Nancy McAdams completed an 860-page magnum opus genealogy of the Wolverton family. I have it sitting on my shelf at home. All the Kallikaks are there. If you know where to start, you can find them all. And there's an appendix that, in fact, helps you find all the Kallikaks. And in that appendix, here's what McDonald and McAdams wrote. They said, "There should be no doubt that John Wolverton," referring to the man whom Goddard referred to as Martin Kallikak Jr., "was a son of Gabriel Wolverton and Catherine Murray. John's parentage would not merit further comment if he had not been described in the Kallikak family, a book published in 1912, as an illegitimate son of John Wolverton and an unnamed feeble-minded tavern girl. When in fact, John Martin Jr. and John Martin Sr. were second cousins, and both perfectly legitimate sons of married parents. Martin Kallikak Jr. was not the illegitimate son of Martin Kallikak Sr. Whether the dalliance with a feeble-minded maid ever occurred, doubtful. Goddard's natural experiment never occurred. There were no Kallos, and there were no Kakos, and there were no Kallikaks. There was no good blood, no bad blood. One line of Wolvertons had access to resources, money, education, health care. Another line of Wolvertons had none of these and were swept with millions of rural Americans and immigrants into the bowels of Americans' urban areas, into lives that were often barely livable. Emma Wolverton moved to the New Jersey State Institution for Feeble-Minded Women in July of 1914. If you'll Google eugenics and sterilization right now, there are two different efforts, in one in Virginia, one in North Carolina, right now to get people who were involuntarily sterilized a retribution for you know, $50,000 to pay for their pain and suffering. But if you listen to the stories, I've heard so many of these, you hear, the women had no idea they were being sterilized. They didn't know what they were undergoing. In many cases, they didn't know until they went to the doctor with their husband to find out why they couldn't have a baby. I mean, I have seen that story. If you read the Buck, Carrie Buck story, which is, she was the person in Buck versus Bell who was sterilized. Her sister had exactly the same thing. Didn't know. So there's a real gender issue there as well. So between 1927 and the 1970s, an estimated 50,000 people labeled feeble-minded were involuntarily sterilized in America. In 1933, the Kallikak family was reprinted in Germany. The same year, Nazi Germany passed the Law for Prevention of Offspring with Hereditary Defects Act. That act was based on the model sterilization law drawn up by American eugenicist Harry Hamilton Lofton, who was a star witness in Buck versus Bell, and it legalized involuntary sterilization of Germans with disabilities. Between 1933 and 1939, an estimated 150,000 Germans with disabilities were forcibly sterilized. Beginning in 1939 and ending in 1941, Nazi officials murdered more than 80,000 Germans with disabilities, many of them who were judged to be feeble-minded.